Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of The Devil's Dream by Lee Smith, narrated by Linda Stevens, supported in order of appearance by Mark Hammer, Sally Darling, Tom Stechschulte, Alyssa Bresnahan, Christina Moore, Ruth Ann Phimister, and C.J. Critt. Lee Smith dedicates this novel to all the real country artists, living and dead, whose music I have loved for so long. And now, The Devil's Dream.
Shall we gather at the river? It's Christmas time at the Opryland Hotel, and you never saw anything like it. Strings of the most beautiful little bitty colored lights, miles and miles of lights, are wrapped around and around every single twig, on every branch, on every tree, hundreds of trees, millions of lights. It must have taken them months to do it. You can't get over it. Not to mention the hotel itself, all lit up like some fairy tale city. Hell, it's as big as a city anyway. Hundreds of rooms, all those restaurants, ballrooms, pools, you name it. Their special displays, such as those darling life-size elves over there hammering away on little red high-heeled shoes, or the animated ballerinas dancing Swan Lake forever and ever on the mirror pond in the middle of the lushly blooming conservatory. There's real strolling singers, such as the Merry Gentlemen, the Seven Singing Dwarves, a trio of snowmen, and a mysterious swashbuckling baritone in a cape singing Silent Night. You can't quite place him, but it don't matter. Maybe he's some lunatic out here on a day trip. Maybe he's a real star. This place is full of real stars. You have to keep an eye out. You might see anybody. And if you do, it's a good bet they'll give you their autograph or maybe even the shirt off their own back. Country stars are real nice. They love their fans in a deep way. They will give of themselves till they drop. This very afternoon, Minnie Pearl is scheduled to read The Night Before Christmas out loud by the giant fireplace. Every child there will get a free gift, not to mention hot chocolate. But look, right now, right over here, flash bulbs are popping like crazy on the porch in front of the old-timey picking parlor. You better hope you got some film left, honey. It must be somebody big. And sure enough, it's Katie Cocker, one of the real superstars of country music, looking just as natural, looking just like herself. But you know, they all look smaller in person than they do on TV. That's a fact. And their heads are all a little bit bigger than they ought to be. You have to have a big head to look good on TV. Of course, Katie's wearing a wig, too. They all wear a wig. Nobody's hair has got that much body. But hers is naturally blonde. That's a fact. You can look back at old photographs from when she was a raindrop, with Mama Rainette and the Raindrops, and see for yourself. Thick yellow hair. Farm girl looks. Level brown eyes, honest as the day is long. A wide, full mouth, that easy smile. Red lipstick. Katie Cocker don't put on airs. She don't have to. She don't have to take off those 12 extra pounds if she don't want to, either. She looks okay. She looks fine. She's made it, and made it her own way. God knows she's paid her dues, too. Some of the events of her life are just tragic, but she's weathered them. She's still here. She's still singing her heart out. It does seem like more things happen to country artists than to anybody else. Have you ever noticed? It's like they have more events in their lives. God knows she's lived through some events. Katie Cocker is well over 40 now and looks it. There's something about her that says, "Hello, honey. This is who I am, and I don't give a damn what you think about me. Take it or leave it," she says. This sassy attitude, coupled with her down-home warmth, has made Katie a big favorite with men and women both. She wouldn't let anybody walk all over her, but she likes men. You can tell. You can always tell. Of course. She's gotten real religious in recent years. All the big stars get religion at a certain point. In fact, that's Billy Jack Reams sitting up there at the table with her. He's the little one wearing the robe. They call him the spiritual leader of the stars. It must be some kind of a press conference. Katie sits up on a stool, surrounded by regular reporters, plus one prim, snippy virgin from the BBC holding a microphone. What's the name of the album? Somebody asks. Shall We Gather at the River? Katie says. That's the name of an old hymn we used to sing in church up on Grassy Branch. Is it going to be all religious songs? Somebody wants to know. Oh, no, not at all, Katie says. It's going to have lots of different kinds of songs on it, as a matter of fact. All of them associated with my family. That's the Bailey family, down over the years. Well, Down by Grassy Branch will be on it for sure, Katie answers another question. And Living on Love, and Melungeon Man. R.C. Bailey wrote both of those, and they were big hits for the Grassy Branch girls. We'll do White Linen, which has always been one of my favorites. It's an old ballad that came into the family when my granddaddy Durwood Bailey married Tampa Raynett in 1910. Yes, Tampa is coming. She really is. My cousin Little Virginia is bringing her and R.C. too. RCA is flying them all over here in a private plane. Lord, I don't even know. About 100, I reckon. They're both bound to be pushing 100. And the Cuckoo Song. It's another old ballad that goes way back. Yes, she is. Rose Annie is definitely coming, too. They're releasing her from Brushy Mountain State Prison just to cut this album. That's one reason we're going to cut it live. I don't know. I just don't know. I'd sure like to have Subdivision Wife on here if she wants to sing it. No, I'm producing this one myself. Yes, that's right. I've formed my own company. This is Carol Bliss, my associate. Heads turn toward Carol Bliss, a trim, dark-haired woman in a red business suit, but no flash bulbs pop. Katie keeps on answering questions. She's real patient with the reporters. She acts like she's got all the time in the world, but Carol Bliss keeps on looking at her watch and rolling her eyes like she's saying, "Oh, brother," in her mind. Young RCA employees circle the scene, facilitating things. They are good at communicating and facilitating. You can tell them by their sculptured haircuts. Christmas carols float through the air. There are so many people crowded up to the porch to watch this interview that strolling hotel guests can hardly push past. A lot of them just stay, in fact, swelling the crowd. "Any minute now," Katie says. "We're expecting them any minute." When Katie Cocker answers a question, she leans forward on her stool and speaks right to the one who asked it. She looks you dead in the eye. "That's a pretty complicated question for me to answer," she says now, slowly, to the woman from the BBC. "I have to admit, there was a time when all I wanted to do was get out of that valley. I was just dying to get away from home. What I didn't understand, all those years when I was waiting for my life to start, was that it had already started. I was already living it. Those were the most important years, and I didn't even know it. But I was real young then, and foolish, like we all are. I wanted to be somebody different. I wanted to be me. And I thought that the way to do this was to put as much distance as possible between me and Grassy Branch. So I did that. And I took some chances. And I got knocked flat a couple of times. I guess I'm Phi Beta Kappa in the school of hard knocks. But I'd get right back up and keep on going. I made a lot of mistakes. I thought I had to do it all by myself, see? It took me a long time to understand that not a one of us lives alone, outside of our family or our time. and that who we are depends on who we were and who our people were. There's a lot of folks in this business that don't believe that, of course. They think you can just make yourself up as you go along. The trick is to keep on moving. But I can't do this. I come from a singing family. We go way back. I know where we're from. I know who we are. The hard part has been figuring out who I am. Because I'm not like any of them. And yet, they are bone of my bone. Part 1. This world is not my home.
There once lived a fair maid named Kate Malone. You could not help but follow. Fell in love with a preacher's son, way down in Cold Spring Holler. He said, put away your dancing shoes, if you would be my donnie. Leave your fiddle hanging on the wall, and cleave unto me only. Come lay with me on my bed of pain. Come lay with me, my lady. There's many a man to give you a ring, but I will give you salvation. Soon Kate, she lost her merry laugh. She was like to lose her beauty. Tied back her hair of purest gold, bore three babes out of duty.
One. Old Man Ira Keen.
That the one you mean? Speak up. Well, that there's the preacher's son, and I'll play it plumb through for you by and by. But first, I'll tell you how come I was to write it in the first place. A song don't just spring out of nowhere, you know. It'll grow in your mind like a honeysuckle vine, just wrapping itself around all the times and all the people and places that is your life. Or that's how it is for me. A song will grow up in my mind unawares, and one day I'll just pick up this here dulcimer, and it'll be there, whole and good and springing to the tune. Well, then I'll sing it, of course. And let me tell you one thing. There ain't nothing in the world to compare with the feeling that comes over you then. It's like, well, this is what happened. I see it all clear now. This is who done what and who said what and how it fell out in the end. For we go through this world with blinders on, just like that mule over yonder a-plowin' in Navy Kale's new ground. It ain't often we're given to see. Seems to me it'll come to me in a song, most likely. That is, if it comes at all, which mostly it don't, of course. This life is a dark valley. It's a vale of tears, as the fellow said. Don't let nobody lie to you and try to tell you any different. Now, I know this to be a fact. Seems like I was born knowing this. Maybe that's why I got along with them Baileys better than most folks. Even old preacher man Bailey, who was mean as a snake and twice as fast. He'd come at you like lightning right in the middle of meeting. He'd grab you up and yell right in your face. I've seen folks run out of the church house just a-hollering when you come towards them. It was near about comical, but you daren't laugh, you know, nor smile, for then he'd turn on you. Big old face like a lantern he had, and a big black hat that he never took off in his head, and that hook for an arm. It was the hook that scared folks the most, I reckon. He'd haul you up by your collar and say, "Ira, Ira, are you among the elected? But you couldn't do nothing about it if you wasn't, but wait for a sign from the Lord. It weren't no use trying to lie about it, neither. Old Sid Bailey could smell a lie like the rest of us can smell a polecat. It weren't no use trying to say you hadn't done something you had done, neither, if and he was churching you for it. Lord, he used to church everybody when he was over here a-preaching. He'd church you for running liquor or walking drunk or saying a bad word or dancing or fiddling or shoeing your horse on a Sunday. I weren't nothing but a shirt-tail boy back then when he was a-preaching, but I knowed better'n to lower my eyes nor to fidget. I thought Sid Bailey was God hisself then, and for aught I know, he might have been. He might have been. For I haven't seen hide nor hair of him since, I tell you that. Not in this here vale of tears. But Sid Bailey was a hard man, and it was a hard doctrine he preached. His church was a church built betwixt a rock and a slick place. God don't need you, Sid Bailey used to say. God'll work his mysterious way, whether or no. And God ain't necessarily with you, neither. As the fella said, you got to walk that lonesome valley by yourself. You'll see temptation to the left of you and temptation to the right of you, but you got to keep on going. This world is not your home. Now, God might come down and give you a sign, or he might not. It don't depend on you. It depends on God. You ain't got a thing to do with it. You can pray till you're blue in the face and do for others till you're near about dead. But God don't give a damn. He's going to do whatever he takes a mind to. And if he does give you a sign, that is a dream or a vision or such like. Well, old Price Warren that lives over there on the mountain, he swears he saw God come rolling at him out in a laurel slick in the form of a great hoop snake. Well, then, you can be baptized. You can join the church if and you could convince old Sid Bailey you wasn't telling a tale, that is. And then it might be, it just might be, mind you, that after you're dead and buried, and if and Jesus Christ comes in the air like he's supposed to on Resurrection Day, and if and he calls out your name, why, then you can rise up out of the dirt and fly straight up to heaven like a jaybird. It's a long shot, ain't it? But that's what Sid Bailey preached and what he believed, and all them hard-shell Baptists down at B Church believe it to this day. You just go down there and ask them. It ain't no different today. Nor will it be no different tomorrow, for they is some folks that wants a doctrine they can't live with. That's a fact. Human beings is nothing if not contrary. They don't want nothing easy, and this is hard. Hard. But I can kindly see it in a way, even if I never could hold to it too good myself. What I figure is any God worth his salt is not going to have no truck with me, you know how. Well, it was in the year 1833, or 1834 as I figured, that Moses Bailey, now that's old Sid's least son, brung young Kate Malone over here to live in that little cabin right down there in Cold Spring Holler. Hell yes, that's what I'm telling you, right down this here hill and across Paint Creek yonder and back in that little bit of cove. You could see the cabin right from this porch where we're sitting, even if it weren't for them cedar trees that had growed up so high over there. That cabin is haunted now, make no mistake about it. Won't nobody venture near it on a bet. I wouldn't go over there for nothing. You stay around here long enough, you'll hear the music when it comes true dark. Fiddle music, of course, what I wrote the song about. It don't happen every night, mind, but when it does, Lord of mercy, it's the sweetest, awfulest sound you ever heard in all your life. I used to could see that cabin real clear, as I was telling you. I used to could see pretty Kate out there of a morning with a baby on her knee playing "This is the way the lady rides," or long toward noon a churning. She'd be barefoot, with the yellow hair all over her head a churning, and singing to beat the band. "Hush, little baby, don't say a word. Pappy's gonna get you a talk
talking bird. And if that talking bird don't sing, Pappy's gonna get you a diamond ring. Well, now, I'm getting to it. Anything worth hearing is worth waiting to hear, as the fella says. Why don't you go in there and reach your hand behind the wood box and bring me out that pint bottle of tonic I've got in there? You can get yourself some of it, I reckon, if you can search up something to put it in. It's a mess in there, ain't it? My widow sister, she set her mind on coming over here to keep house for me after old Piney died, but I done run her off. I don't need your fooling around here, says I, nor your infernal messing. You go on, says I, and leave me alone in my mind. I ain't worried with a mess in the kitchen, I says. I ain't studying here now. In fact, if you used to ask me what I ate for dinner yesterday, I'd be hard-pressed to answer you. Yet, when I think on Kate Malone, the years slide away like a pretty lady letting her dressing gown fall to the floor, and I see her ever clear in my mind's eye and ever young as she was then. I loved her, of course, but it was a love as pure as the driven snow, with never a hope of heaven, and all the sweeter for it. Kate Malone was 15, maybe 16, when Moses Bailey married her and brung her over there to Cold Spring Holler to live. Sid Bailey had died preaching at a brush arbor meeting over in Madison County. The old lady had died previous, and the young'uns had scattered every which way. I was 12 years old, living right here on Crow Hill with my mama and my daddy. They was Hazel and Jesse Keene, and three sisters, and my daddy's Uncle Gabe, and my brother that weren't quite right, dummy. He always lived on the place here, first with mama and daddy, and then with me and Piney until he died. Dummy was sweet, you know, but he couldn't hold nothing in his mind. Never did work, couldn't work. Used to sit right over there in that little rocking chair and whistle. Whistled like a bird. Pour me a little bit more of that, if you will. Just a sweetener. The first time I saw Kate, I thought to myself, now that is the prettiest gal I will ever lay eyes on in my life. And it remains so to this day. For we'd seed her daddy's wagon come, and trunks, and general bustlement, and now smoke was rising out of the chimney again. So I says to myself, well, I'll go. I'll go on over there and see what they's to see. I recollect it was October. The sky was as blue as Mama's Dutch plate, and red and yellow leaves was blowing crazy. Kate sat out on the porch in a little rocker, wearing a green dress and a brown shawl with a cameo pin at her neck, a-playing with a baby doll that she'd brung with her from home and singing, go to sleep, little baby, for the booger man gets you. When you wake, you'll have a piece of cake and all the pretty little horses. She was rocking the baby doll. Her hair fell down past her shoulders, all gold and merry wild. Her eyes was big and wide apart and gray, the softest gray like kitten fur. Her lips is full and pouty and cherry red. She kept right on singing. Are you a girl or a missus? I asked her finally. And she liked to die laughing. Then, I'm the missus here, she said. I married Moses Bailey. Morning, another voice said then, and out in the cabin door stepped Moses Bailey. Well, he was handsome, I'll grant him that. Curly black hair and blue eyes and well set up, a stout, strapping young man. He come out on the porch, and I said who I was, Ira Keene from over on Crow Hill, and he made some manners, but I could tell he weren't studying me at all in that moment. His eyes never left her face. He had eyes kindly like his daddy, sharp as the point of a knife. K Kate sung on a rocking. "It won't be long and I'll give you a baby doll sure enough," Moses said. And Kate laughed her merry laugh at him, but it was true. Come next August, they had them a little baby girl, and Kate thought the world of her. She thought the sun rose and set on that child, which was all to the good, since by then it was clear that everything was not sweetness and light in that cabin in Cold Spring Holler. For Moses was one of them that will not be satisfied. One of them that's always hankering after something that's just around the next bend. He couldn't never settle down, seemed like. He'd farm a little bit, but not serious-like, not enough to do no good. And then he'd be running a raft of logs down the Monongah for somebody, or trading some horses for somebody else. But most times, he was off at a preaching someplace, or traipsing the woods alone. See, Moses wanted to make a preacher the worst in the world, just like his daddy had done. But God wouldn't give him no sign. So Moses, he kept on looking for one. He used to go to meetings all round and offer up the prayer. Other times he'd go off in the woods by himself, hankering after his sign. Kate and the children was just living hand to mouth whilst he was gone. For they'd been two more babes since that first one, which was Mary Magdalene. There was now Jeremiah and little Ezekiel besides. It liked to worry my mama to death. I couldn't count you the number of times she sent me over there with a turn of meal or a sack of taters for Kate and them little children. One time, when I was carrying them a mess of beans, I asked Kate point blank. I said, "Where's your old man anyway?" And Kate just smiled her sunny smile at taking the cook pot from me and said, "Well, Ira, he is off wrestling with the angel." Come to find out, this is the truth, and the whole truth of it. Now, if it's a woman your old man is gone after, at least you got a sheep to set yourself up against and somebody to get mad at. But if it's God, well, your hands is plumb tied, ain't they? Pretty Kate was stymied for sure. And Moses, being as mule-headed as ever his daddy was, he wouldn't give it up for nothing. The more God denied him a sign, the more determined Moses was to get one. He figured that the more he prayed and run the woods a-looking, the more likely he was to find his sign. Moses went from being a big husky feller to a scarecrow, and the bones in his face stuck out in a way that called old Sid to mind. But Moses had got to where nobody could beat him a-praying, that's for damn sure. He'd give out the prayer in meeting once a month, which is however often they held it then, and he prayed everybody else under the table. That little old mealy-mouthed circuit rider that was coming over here then, that little Mr. Graves, I think it was, couldn't hold a candle to Moses Bailey. He had a voice like the Bible, Moses had. Why, we could hear him plumb over here sometimes of an evening, if the wind was right, praying over their supper till you know it had growed stone cold. Now, it would have been hard on anybody, of course, to have their old man get turned that away, but it was particular hard on Kate Malone, for she was naught but a gal, and she'd come from the fun-lovinest family you ever seed. They lived on the other side of Lone Bald Mountain there at Cana. As Kate was the only gal left at home, they all doted on her and waited on her hand and foot. She wasn't raised to bear the life that she fell into. Kate wasn't. Her daddy, Pink Malone, was the best fiddler around those parts, and every one of them boys fiddled, too. It was always music and laughing and frolics over at Cana. They'd run a set at the drop of a hat. They'd still be a-dancing when the sun come up. So you couldn't have found two families more different-like than the Baileys and the Malones. Moses didn't make no bones about it. When he asked old Pink for to marry Kate, he said right out that there was to be no music at the wedding. Then Pink looked over at Kate, and she cried and said, "Oh, please, Daddy, this is the man I want with all my heart." So there wasn't nothing that Pink could say or do to stop them. They was married indeed, though it said that Kate's mama took her to her bed the day of the wedding. She she is that upset about it, and it's further said that all Kate's brothers fell on the ground a-crying when Moses took her away. Moses wouldn't hardly let her go back over there to visit, neither. He said that the devil walked in that house and that fiddle music was the voice of the devil laughing. Well, time passed, and I growed up to be about as sorry and wild as any young buck in the county, but when it come to Mrs. Kate Malone, I would have laid down at her feet and died if she'd asked me to. I was keeping company with first one gal and then the other, but couldn't none of them lay a glove on Kate Malone, to my way of thinking. Sometimes I'd get all hot and bothered thinking about her over there in that holler and how Moses Bailey had done her. And one day I determined to speak up about it. I believe I must have been about 18 years old at the time, so you can reckon about how much I knowed. Kate, she would have been in her early 20s by then, and she's already losing her bloom, like so many gals does around here, wore out by work and children. I swear it's a sight what all a woman puts up with. I tell you this now, but I never give it a thought back then, when I was as heedless and unthoughtless as any critter in the forest, back when it might have done somebody some good. Nope. Kate wasn't as pretty as she was when she come over the mountain from her daddy's house at Cana, but she didn't appear to have lost all her spirit neither, despite of her sad lot. Do you reckon Kate knows that she's ill-used? I mused to myself, crossing Paint Creek on my horse. For if a body don't know something, it don't worry them at all, of course. It's knowledge that's the root of all evil, as the fellow said. It was late November when I rode over there this time. Daddy and me had killed 2 hogs 3 or 4 days previous. I was taking Kate some hog meat and cracklings. That was just my excuse, don't you know, for I determined to see how things set with her. I'd been sparking a girl over at Hanging Rock, and somehow I felt I couldn't do no real business over there before I ascertained the state of things with Kate. From the creek, I seed smoke rising, and when I rode into the Bailey's clearing, I seed Kate herself out there in a man's black coat, a-stirring something in a big black kettle over the cook fire. "Ira," she said. She always said my name like she's glad to see me. "I'm just stirring up some apple butter," she said. "Hitch and light," she said. "It's near about done, and I'll send some home to your mama, who's been so kind to me." "How is your mama?" she said, and I said that mama was tolerable, all the time studying Kate real close-like. Her cheeks was red from the heat of the fire, and her hair had tumbled down. She kept it tied back all the time. She tried to put it back now, but she couldn't afford to quit stirring the apple butter. "Just sit down and wait a minute," she said, and I hunkered down right where I was and smoked a cigarette. I looked around good. It struck me how lonesome the cabin was, set back in the cedar trees that-a-way, despite her children playing all around the steps. It was kind of dark back in there, and the cold wind come a-blowing through them cedar trees with a sighing sound, a crying sound, real mournful-like. The feel of the forest was all round. With the leaves off in the trees, you could see how close the mountain rose up there behind the cabin, and how rocky and mean it looked. Now that's Lone Bald Mountain. You see it over there. It's not a pretty mountain, either. There's a cropping out of rocks yonder, right afore you reach the bald where the ravens stay, and it used to be in them days that bears was frequent on Lone Bald, too. Kate's cabin was mighty close to the mountain, to my mind, and mighty far removed from the rest of us'ns living around here. "Jeremiah! Get me some water, honey," Kate said, and the eldest boy run up to the spring with the bucket. They loved their mama, you can just tell it, and there's never any back talk nor squabbling amongst them. Them and Kate was all kids together, it appeared. Jeremiah come back with the bucket, and Kate doused the fire. She licked the end of the sassafras stick she was stirring apple butter with and grinned at me. My heart liked to leap out in my chest. "This'll eat real good," she said. "Come on over here and try it." and I rose up like I was in a dream and went over there where she was. I felt like my legs was lead, but my heart was beating double time, and she held out the stick and giggled. And I licked the apple butter off of it, and then I dipped the stick down and held it for her while she licked it. It was real hot and real sweet. It burned my tongue. I looked at Kate in the old black coat, and I looked at her raggedy youngins barefoot despite of the cold, and I listened to the wind a-moaning and a-sighing through them cedar trees, and a resolve took a hold of me. "Kate Bailey," I says, "how come you stay over here this way when your man ain't never home?" "You ought to have better," says I, all hot in the face. And to her credit, Kate didn't laugh at me. "Why, Ira Keene," she says. "Why, Ira." And for just a minute, she laid her hand upside my face. For just a minute, she stopped stock still and stared straight in my eyes. We stayed like that for a while. The cold wind blowed her hair around. Then, "Moses needs me," she says, real soft-like. "He needs me so much," she says. Now, I didn't know nothing about that then, being not but 18, but I do now. For need is the powerfulest tie that they is, it seems to me now, for a woman in particular. But at the time Kate said it, it fair broke my heart. And I reckon I got on my horse some way and made it back across Paint Creek some way, but whether I carried Mama any of that apple butter or not, I couldn't tell you. I do know I got knee-walking drunk that night out in the smokehouse, where Pappy thought he'd hit his liquor so good. And Pappy whipped me for it. To tell you the truth, I didn't care if he whipped me or not. I wanted him to whip me, if I couldn't have Kate Malone. My heart was broke for sure. Now this is what, 60, 70 year ago? And yet I can see her still standing by that cook fire in the wind, her skirts and her hair blowing, giving me that sassafras stick to lick. I see her rosy cheeks. And yet it weren't long after that I had taken Piney Wilfong down to B for somebody's wedding, and the axle broke and the horse run off, and there we was out all night long, and it was said I ought to marry her to make it right, which I done, and brung her up here, and she as good as gold to dummy, and give me 9 children to boot, which is all gone now, finally and effectually. 2 boys dead in the war, and 2 more I done lost track of, and another boy and 4 gals that lives here and there. They bring their young'uns up here to see me infrequent. They ain't got no use for young'uns. And Piney, dead in the ground these 20 year. Seems to me a queer thing that I live with that old woman near about 50 year, and she's a good wife, mind you, and yet I cannot now recall her face for the life of me. Not the way I recall Kate Malone the day she made the apple butter when we was young. Anyway, I'd done been caught and trussed by Piney when all the trouble started over there in Cold Spring Holler. It commenced when Kate's ma took sick at Cana and they sent for Kate, so Moses Bailey had to let her go. She'd taken Jeremiah with her, leaving Mary Magdalene to watch little Zeke and do for their daddy, who prayed over them out in the yard before they left, riding on 2 white mules. Well, it was 2 days of riding over Lone Bald Mountain in those days, and when they got there, come to find out that Kate's mama had took a upturn. So Kate and her mama just fell on each other's necks crying, it said, and they was muching over Jeremiah that they hadn't seed since he was a babe. So Kate and Jeremiah stayed on a few days to visit. And one night, Jeremiah noted a fiddle hanging on the wall and said, "Granddaddy, what's that?" And Pink took it down and played it for him. And Jeremiah fair loved it. He took to the fiddle like a duck to water, and when they got back home, it was the first thing he told his daddy about the trip. "Now you hark me, Moses said, his voice deep and terrible. The fiddle is an instrument of the devil, and if you ever take it up, you'll have to leave home, for you won't be my boy no more, you'll be the devil's boy. And then he put both hands on Jeremiah's head and prayed on him. So that was the end of that, until the following summer, when Kate's mama took sick again, and this time Moses was off running a raft of logs down the Monongah River for a fella. So Kate just up and lit a rag for home without so much as a by your leave to Moses, and got there just in time to see her mama buried. Now, I don't know but what this might have made Kate kind of reckless, for when Jeremiah asked for the fiddle again, Kate allowed it, and she allowed Pink to play it for him. And then it said that Kate herself took her own little fiddle down from the wall where it had been hanging ever since she went off to Cold Spring Holler. She took it out on the porch of her daddy's fine big cabin over at Cana and sat out there all night long a-fiddling. Everything she'd ever knowed come back to her. Barbara Allen, Cripple Crick, Shady Grove, The Devil's Dream, I Gave My Love a Cherry That Had No Stone. Jeremiah, he couldn't get over his mama playing that away. But come morning, she put her little fiddle back up on the wall and busted out a-crying. I tell you what, old Pink Malone says to Kate when they're saddled up to leave. Honey, you take this fiddle, it's yourn, on home with you, wrapped up in these your gunny sacks. And you teach the boy to play it whenever his daddy's away. The boy has got an ear for it, Pink said. Besides, it's a sin to put your talent under a bushel, Pink said. You know, a feller can quote scripture to make it come out however it suits him. Well, Kate, she looked at the fiddle, and she looked at Jeremiah's face, and she looked at the fiddle again, and her whole heart was filled with longing. So she'd taken the fiddle. And from then on, every time Moses was away, why, we could hear him out there making music on the porch. Even the little un was learning, that little Zeke. And Mary had the sweetest high, thin voice. Down in the valley, valley so low, she'd sing, hang your head over, hear the wind blow. They didn't have no way of knowing how good the sound carried up here, I reckon, since they hadn't hardly ventured off in that place. Well, it used to give Mama the all-overs, and Piney too, that singing. No good'll come of this, Mama said. But Dummy loved it. He used to tap his foot and pat his knee in time. Winter come, and we didn't hear no fiddling. And then spring come with a big early thaw. Now, Moses' garden never done much, and the previous summer wasn't no exception. So by spring, they was about out of everything that Kate had put by to eat. They was living on apples and taters. So Moses, he resolved to run a raft of logs down the river for old man Higgins and get him some cash money. It was a lot more water around here then. The Monongah was a big, mighty river in them days. It might take me longer than usual to get back up here, Moses warned Kate. I might have trouble crossing them little streams on the way back, for some of them is all swole up now and busting over their banks. I'll be aiming for about 6 days, Moses said. So then he kissed her and set out afore the sunrise. Well, that day, don't you know, Kate and Jeremiah took the fiddle out in the hidey hole in the corn crib where they'd been a-keeping it and tuned it up, and that night they set out on the porch a-fiddling and a-singing. They sung and sung. They sung the moon up. They didn't have no way of knowing that Moses' raft had broke into smithereens right soon after he set out when he come to a big curve with some sharp rocks over to the left of it. That he was aware of, but this year the Monongah was so high Moses couldn't get his bearings, so he run right smack into them rocks and the raft busted all to pieces, throwing Moses into the river in the logs every which way. Moses was lucky not to drown. Point of fact, he'd like to have drowned, but he managed to cling on to one of the logs for dear life and come around. He stopped at a house to dry himself and set out walking for home. Now, who knows what Moses was a-thinking on that long, dark walk home? For his pretty wife and his children had nothing but taters to eat, and he was coming home with nothing in his pockets. It must have seemed to him that God, who Moses had been looking for all his days, was just a-mocking him. God had flung him in the river and left him for dead. Is it a sign? He must have wondered. Is it a test? So Moses was walking through the dark, dripping trees alongside a paint creek and pondering on God and his ways, when all of a sudden he heard the devil's laughter on the wind. Now what it was, of course, was his own wife Kate, a-fiddling a frolic tune and singing, "Goodbye, girls, I'm going to Boston early in the morning." Moses hastened on. And when he come to the edge of the clearing, he could see him as good as anything in the light of the risen moon. They didn't even need no lantern. It was Kate, with Mary Magdalene and Jeremiah gathered round her. Little Zeke had fell asleep on a pallet at her feet. Then Kate handed Jeremiah the fiddle. "Saddle up, girls, and let's go with 'em. Saddle up, girls, and let's go with 'em." Jeremiah had a fine, light touch. Now, who knows what went on in Moses' head while he stood there listening? Who can say what drives a man to do the things he does? For what Moses done was awful. He come busting out of them woods like God himself, a-hollering, snatched that fiddle and broke it over the front porch rail, and then beat all of them, Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Mary and Kate too, until the children run off in the woods to get away from him. At the last, he throwed himself down on the floor and cried like a baby the rest of the whole night long. Or so Kate told it to Mama, who went over there the next day and learned the whole sorry story. One side of Kate's pretty face was black and blue, and her eye was swole shut. But Moses was the one in torment, Mama said, gnashing his teeth over what he'd done and moaning deep moans and a-praying out loud to God. Kate never left his side, Mama said, nor took a thought for herself, and it appeared to Mama that Kate loved Moses more than ever, despite of what he'd done. She said Kate's face gave off a light that calmed all who come around her that day, and so before long Moses himself calmed down, and Mary and Zeke come back, and Moses kissed them, and then Mama come on home. It fair broke my heart to hear what she had to say. But Jeremiah never come back home. 1-2 days passed. "He was right there with us," Mary and Zeke said. "We was all together in the woods," they said. But he never come back home. Moses felt awful about it, for Jeremiah was his eldest son, and if the truth be told, his favorite. And then Kate remembered how Moses had told Jeremiah he'd have to leave if he ever took up the fiddle, and they determined that Jeremiah must have gone over Lone Bald Mountain by himself to stay with Kate's family at Cana. So Moses saddled up his horse and went over there to get Jeremiah and bring him back. But when he got halfway up the mountain, Moses seen all these ravens around the rock cave wheeling and dipping in the sky. He rode over there to take a look. And sure enough, it was his own son, Jeremiah, 2 days dead, having fell down the rocky cliff in the dark of trying to get to Cana, and the ravens had ate out his eyes. Well, of course Moses put his son's body across his saddle and brung him back, and we buried him there under the cedar trees, for Kate wouldn't let us take him back up the mountain where the Bailey burying ground lays. "I want him home," Kate said. She said it real calm, too calm, and her eyes was too big in her head. But everything was done as she desired. And then she appeared to go on as usual, cooking and churning and gathering eggs and such like, and speaking reasonable to all the neighbor folks that come by, bringing this or that to help out. Kate never said nothing about Jeremiah, whose grave you could see from the porch, nor yet about Moses, who'd gone off again, wandering the mountains, it said, praying out loud and mournful at all hours of the day and night. Some said they'd seen him down on the Monongah, or over at White Oak, or at Bee. Two fellers swore they heard Moses a-praying as they rode through Flat Gap going toward Sistersville, but they couldn't roust him out in the forest. Well, time passed, and it was full summer, and finally Moses come on back home. But he come home only to die. We reckoned it was a pneumonia, for he laid there thin as a rail with a rattle in his chest and coughed himself to death. And whenever he weren't coughing, Moses continued to pray aloud. I questioned Kate on this. Oh, no, he hasn't lost his faith, Kate said, bright as a new penny. He's bent himself to the rule of God, which we cannot hope to fathom, she said. He hopes he may hold out faithful to the end. Now, as you might imagine, word got out, and folks come from all around to hear Moses pray and to see him that away, and there was some several folks converted on the spot. But there wasn't nobody present excepting Kate when Moses coughed his last and died. Or, as Piney used to say, when he crossed over to the other side. Piney was a good old woman. I wished I'd loved her better. I wished I hadn't give her such a time. I reckon she's on the other side now, old Piney is, if there is one. I don't reckon I'll be joining her over there neither. I tell you, I hold with old Sid Bailey on that. You gotta walk that lonesome valley by yourself. And I ain't looking for company. Now, I'll admit to you, I might have had some idea of going around Cold Spring Holler and seeing what all I could do for Kate after Moses died. But the pure fact was that Kate died too, finally and effectually, when Moses went. The Kate that I'd knowed and loved, I mean, that Kate Samarian Spiritus that sung on the porch while she churned and danced with her babes in the yard. Kate Malone went plumb out in her head then, it's sad to say. You couldn't get her to speak a word of sense. She was so busy a-talking with them people in her mind, Moses and Jeremiah and Lord knows who else, and singing little bitty snatches of songs. Sometimes she'd wrap up her head in a shawl and say the ravens was after her. Sometimes she'd be laughing and laughing. Sometimes she'd shush you and say the ravens was a-whispering in her ear. Well, it weren't long before they come over here from Cana, some of her daddy's people, and taken her children away. Seemed like she didn't hardly miss them, neither. Now, they tried to take Kate, too, but she refused to go. She wouldn't leave that cabin. I seen Kate one more time afore she died. She'd been a-living all alone for a year or more, and it was summer again, just about dusk when I walked over there. Kate sat on the porch in a rocking chair, where I'd seen her so many times, and singing just like she used to. Go to sleep, little baby, for the booger man gets you. When you wake, you'll have a piece of cake and all the pretty little horses. Her hair had gone plumb white, but her voice was as sweet as ever. She looked real peaceful. Kate, I says, it's Ira. A black and a bay, and a dapple and a gray, she sung. Kate Malone, I says. So go to sleep, little baby, Kate sung. And I seed it was hopeless. I don't think she even knowed me. I left her there whilst the lightning bugs was arising from the tall grass that had growed up all round the cabin, and a little wind was a sign through the cedar trees. I thought I heard a whisper in the breeze, and when I looked back at the cabin from the edge of the forest, I couldn't even see Kate there on the porch. I couldn't do naught but hear her singing in the dark. I believe I'll take a little more of that there. Just a drop, if you don't mind. What'd I do? Well, I'll tell you. I left there that night with my heart like to bustin', for a young man is a sorry wild thing, truth to tell. He don't even know what he wants, but he wants it so bad it's like to kill him all the time. Nor did I go home to that good wife of mine. Nope. I walked down the creek past B to Reese Stiltner Bottom, where a woman I knowed named Becky Trent lived, and she's glad to see me. She's always glad to see me. But she weren't nothing like Kate Malone. That's why it don't bother me none to stay up here the way I do now. It don't bother me having that handed cabin across the way there. Hell, that fiddle music don't even bother me most times. Now, I won't go over there, mind you, on a bit. But I kindly like to hear that music. Most times it'll start up about now. Just about dark. And if it's a dance tune, why, sometimes I'll lean my head back and close these old eyes and listen. And them times, it'll seem like I can fair see us. Kate and me together as we never was in life. A waltzing in the dark.
2. Ezekiel Bailey. Small wonder, then, that Zeke grew up so mealy-hawed and close-mouthed, a big boy with a face as fair and blank as the full moon. It wasn't that he was obstinate or contrary. It was simply that he had nothing to say. And he could sit still for hours and not do a blessed thing. It was unnatural. Everybody said so. Zeke was passed around his mama's family at Cana like a hot potato, staying with first these cousins, then those cousins, then his lonely old great-aunt Edith over at Honey Camp. But nobody would keep him long. Not even Edith. They'd make some excuse and pass him on. For the pure fact was, Zeke spooked them. He spooked them all. They were not used to a big old boy that wouldn't say a word. It made them feel bad, like they ought to do something about him. But they couldn't think what. For he wouldn't work. He wouldn't play. He didn't even want to shoot a gun. Finally, they got tired of thinking up things for him to do. Finally, they grew to hate the very sight of him sitting hunched on the floor that-a-way, staring into the fire. Ain't nothing to see in a fire. And they couldn't stand the way he kept his head cocked like a robin all the time, either. Like he was listening out for something. For what? It wasn't natural. Finally, Zeke ended up living with his Aunt Dot, his mother's older sister, and her husband, Clovis Kincaid, and their 11 children in that tumble-down place at Frog Level, out from Cana. Zeke had never seen so many kids. All of them all the time laughing and crying and fighting, snot-nosed and gap-toothed, running here and there. They all looked alike, fair and tow-headed, just like Zeke. He fit right in, or appeared to. So he liked it there. It was loud and rough over at Frog Level, and sometimes the boys ganged up on him. And sometimes there was not enough food to go around at supper, but Zeke liked it fine over there. Nobody paid him any mind. They'd say, "Go down there and get the cow," or "Watch this little 'un, honey," or "Chop me some wood now." They did not say, "What air you thinkin', honey? Or what air you listenin' out fur?" like his great-aunt Edith used to.
They never asked him any questions at all, which was a good thing. For even as a child, Zeke had sense enough not to tell anybody about the voices in his head, or that other sound he always heard, like wind through a cave. The only way Zeke knew to shut off that sound was to sit still, real still. But then they sent him over to frog level, where the Kincaids drowned it out. So Zeke could relax a little bit now. He could grow up some. He could shoot marbles with his cousin Tom, or get in a wrestling match with Dan, or play house with Jane and Pansy, or hide-go-seek in the woods until it got too dark to see, and then he could fall on the bed, tick-exhausted, and sleep in a smelly pile of boys. Girls in the front room, boys in the back room, Aunt Dot and Uncle Clovis in the middle room with the babies. Kitchen just a jerry-built lean-to against the side of the house. Sometimes Dot would kiss you, and sometimes she'd slap you. She was a good cook, who grew fatter and sassier as the years wore on. And Dot was a Malone through and through when it came to singing, with a high nasal voice that sent a chill up and down Zeke's backbone. After supper, she'd rear back and close her eyes and set to singing by the fire or on the porch, depending on the season. And the children that wanted to would join in while Clovis sat with his arms folded and his mouth in a line and did not sing, but didn't leave either. Clovis seemed to enjoy the singing. But you could never tell about him, famous for silence. Cousin Willie or Uncle Cornelius came by sometimes with their fiddles. Dan was taking up the fiddle too, but Zeke refused to learn it. And when he said no to Cousin Willie's offer, his other cousins all stopped dead in their tracks and looked at each other. And Willie never asked him again. But Zeke liked music, and he liked to sing. Oh, get around, Jenny, get around, oh, get around, I say. While Cousin Willie bit his lip and perspired, and the fiddles went faster and faster. Oh, get around, Jenny, get around, long summer day. Zeke would spin in the yard like a whirligig, faster and faster and faster, until all the world was a green blur that looked like the sound in his head. When he finally fell to ground, his head would be completely clear, like the summer sky with no cloud in sight. Sometimes, right then, he could remember his mother. He remembered her gray eyes and her clear voice, and how she smoothed the hair back from his forehead when he ran in from the yard and grabbed her skirts. He remembered her saying, "Now I lay me down to sleep at night." But most times, he couldn't remember his mother. So that when Great-Aunt Edith told him she was dead that first summer they took him away from her, it meant nothing. Nothing to him at all. He just looked up at Great-Aunt Edith, whose chin started quivering like jelly when she told him before she started to cry. Then Edith stood there on the porch staring at the boy for the longest time. Then she flung her apron over her face and ran back in the cabin crying. Zeke stood right where he was and did not think about her, or about his mother, or about anything. It was hot on the porch. Red roses bloomed, climbing up over the porch rail of Edith's cabin at Honey Camp. Later that day, Edith gave him a special marble, a steely, which was exactly the kind Zeke had always wanted. And how did she know that? How could she possibly know? "Where'd this come from?" he asked, holding it, and Edith said it had belonged to a dead boy. Then she started up crying again. Later, she put on her bonnet and walked him down to the store and got him some whorehound candy. Zeke kept the steely in his pocket always, and sometimes he'd roll it around and around in his fingers, and no one knew. He never traded it, or shot with it, or even took it out of his pocket. The only person he showed it to was his big cousin Tom, his favorite. Ezekiel himself would grow up after all, or if he did not grow up exactly, he would at least change from a too solemn child to a too solemn young man. He would stay on at frog level, working the hard rock ground with Clovis, who was a man that didn't talk to women and children and never appeared to notice Ezekiel at all. So that Zeke wondered at first if his uncle even knew he was present in the house. Until it came time to clear the field that first year, that is. Then his uncle let on that he knew, all right. For Zeke was a large, strong lad, and Clovis aimed to make him earn his keep. Zeke didn't mind working, truth to tell. He was never much for school, where he sat like a bump on a log and refused to recite. Zeke would bite his lip and stare through the open schoolhouse door at the mountains while Mr. Green caned him unmercifully, until Zeke's face grew fiery red and Pansy started crying, "Is this yet enough, Ezekiel?" Mr. Green would gasp, the slick yellow strands of his oily hair stuck to his head with perspiration. Mr. Green was a slight young fellow with pale skin, spectacles, and a constant cough. It was harder for him to beat Ezekiel than it was for Ezekiel to take the beating. Both Zeke and Mr. Green were relieved when Clovis sent word that he'd need the boys, that it was time to clear the fields for planting. And Zeke loved it out there on the long hillside. He loved the feel and smell of the dirt on his hands as they grabbled out the rocks, the ghostly look of the bare trees in the morning fog, the faint pink mist of the first redbud, then the purple sarvis, then the white blur of dogwood as spring came on and the birds showed up and the woods grew green again. One famous day when he was 12, Zeke put himself in harness with Buck, the mule, when they couldn't for the life of them pull out a particularly recalcitrant stump out of the stony new ground they were clearing. Zeke strained forward as hard as ever he could. The other kids pushed on the back of the stump. Tom beat the mule. Finally, with a long, wrenching, sucking sound, the stump pulled free, spewing pebbles every place, and laid upended there on the hill for days, looking for all the world like a witch head with big spiky root hairs sticking out. Then the day came when they burned it, and all the other brush besides, in a great wildfire on the hillside that caused Zeke's heart to beat so fast. He loved the acrid smell of the wood smoke, and the way it looked disappearing into the cloudy sky. He stayed up there on the hill all night long and watched the fire burn itself out, and then worked all the next day, too, with the rest of them, and never missed the sleep. Later, Zeke was the one that walked behind Buck, holding the bull-tongued plow to a furrow as straight as any man's, so that Clovis, watching him, hit upon the notion of renting Zeke out to whoever needed him in the field. Clovis told Zeke that he would not have to go back to school. Zeke liked this idea fine. So Zeke settles into his life. He gets up in the morning and eats his Aunt Dot's good biscuits and her red-eye gravy. He walks to work. He works. He talks some to the people he's working for. He walks back to frog level. He eats. He sleeps. He gives the money he makes to his Uncle Clovis, who gives him back some. Zeke doesn't need much. It has not occurred to him to ask for more. It has not occurred to him to do anything else or to go anyplace else. He wears overalls, brogans, and a plaid shirt, winter and summer. He fucks a widder woman over at Cana that he works for regular. It seems to be part of his job. She cuts his hair for him, too. And he loves to dance. He is known for it. On Saturday nights, he'll go anywhere, travel any distance to find a dance, and he'll dance as long as anybody will fiddle. He'll dance all night long if he can. At these dances, he treats all the girls in the same courtly, old-fashioned manner, even the girls that are known to go back of the barn with you, the girls Tom has told him about. Ezekiel is a serious, dedicated, trance-like dancer. Sometimes a girl will start to look at him in another way, but usually this does not last long. For there is something in his face, or there is a lack of something in his face, that puts them off. They stop flirting. Oh, they like Ezekiel fine. They'll tease him and dance with him. But it isn't serious flirting. They wouldn't walk with him on Sunday if he asked them, which he does not. They don't treat Ezekiel like a man, somehow. Sometimes Ezekiel goes with his uncles, if they are running a set someplace away from here, at Sistersville or Little Africa, or Ash Holler, or even as far away as Holly Grove. One time, at a dance over in Sistersville, a pretty woman comes up to Zeke and grabs him away from his partner, grabs him off the floor. She is slight, with curly flyaway hair. She wears a frilly red dress with puff sleeves. She pulls him away from the dancing. "Zeke," she says. "Zeke." The fiddle saw away. The air is close in there. And Zeke wipes sweat off his face and looks at her. There is something about her. "Zeke, is it you?" she says. Zeke keeps looking at her, but he can't think what to say. While he watches, her big eyes fill with tears. Then she puts her hand up to her mouth and pushes past him roughly, through the throng of people out the door. Zeke follows after her. He makes it to the door just in time to see her off into the night, hanging on the arm of the big feller who is waiting for her there. "Mary," Zeke calls out. His voice is rusty and odd, so that everybody out there stops drinking and smoking and talking and turns to look at the enormous boy silhouetted by the light pouring out of the dance hall door. His hair glows fiery pale, like bright angel hair in that light. But Mary Magdalene and the man she is with have already disappeared into the darkness beyond the dance. All you can see of them is the glow of the man's cigarette in the dark. And it is his voice that calls back to Zeke from wherever they are going to. "Sorry, buddy." As if there has been some mistake. Ezekiel will not see Mary again. A restless, wild girl, she will move eventually from Sistersville to Knoxville, where she will get in trouble. And Zeke, standing in the doorway, has already forgotten her. Her very name, Mary, drowned out by the sound in his head. He goes down the steps and buys some liquor from a man. After the dance is over, he goes with his cousins, Willie and Tom, to a whorehouse in Sistersville, where a girl takes off her clothes slow for him, stopping at the black garter belt and stockings. Zeke has never seen such a contraption. When he shoots off inside her, the noise in his head goes away, and then he sleeps. The next day, Willie keeps vomiting as they ride back over to Cana under the blazing noon sky, and Tom keeps laughing. "How's your hammer hanging, Zeke?" Tom asks him, and Zeke says, "Fine." The other thing that Zeke likes is meeting. It helps him the way a woman and a fiddle tune help him. It quiets his head. Even though the Malones are widely known as backsliders, they all tend the old Pisgah Primitive Baptist Church set back on the ridge toward Cana. This church, raised by its congregation in 1831, is nothing but a square cabin made of notched and chinked logs, with a puncheon floor, a single small window on each side, and a plain pine door. It stands in a high clearing on the hill, with a good view of the road to Cana and the frog-level bottom, and a glimpse of the dismal river beyond. There's always a breeze up on that hill. Having the graveyard right next to the church keeps things in the proper perspective. There's no steeple, no sign, no bell to indicate that this small, plain cabin is in fact a church. But the stern, lonesome air of holiness hangs everywhere about it, like fog on the ridge of a morning. Ezekiel walks up here every third Sunday with the rest. Other Sundays, some of them go to other meetings, often traveling miles. For many of them, especially the women, this is the only time they will ever go anywhere. They approach the church house soberly and quietly, eyes cast down. Horses and mules and wagon teams are hitched in the woods. Some of the wagons have little children sleeping on pallets inside or sucking quietly on a sugar tit. Newborns are carried into meeting. Older children are left at home, meeting is not the place for children. The women go on in. Most of the men stand around outside the church house smoking or chewing tobacco until the singing starts. Then they throw their cigarettes down on the ground and spit out their chaws and file in two, men to the right, women to the left. They sit on hard plank benches. Meeting is not supposed to be comfortable. Inside the Pisgah church house is as plain as it is outside. Nothing but a pot-bellied stove in the back and a homemade table to lay your coats on in the winter time. Nothing up front but the rough-hewn pulpit in the center and the Amen corner over to the side. A wood platform with chairs on it for visiting elders to sit on. No cross, no pictures, no ornamentation of any kind. Christ don't need no fancy cross, as old Elder Stump has been heard to say. No choir, no hymn books, no organ, no piano, no instruments of any kind. Christ don't have no truck with the things of this world. Cornelius Malone leads the singing by just flat starting out with it all of a sudden, his high nasal voice almost like an assault on the rustling hush in the meeting house. It's the old ship of Zion as she comes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.